We have section A, which I have indicated that it is actually compulsory. So it is a multiple choice question. So the first question reads, in a job contract, a probation period could refer to a cycle where the correct answer for this particular question would be where employers finalize the skills training, where employers finalize the skills training for new workers. So that is known as the probation period. So in this case, our correct answer will be the letter D. Moving on to the next question. A health-related intervention program refers to a. So when we are talking about an intervention program, we are talking about the activity which you actually do to address health risk factors. So the most suitable answer here would be D, which reads a set of activities targeting health risk factors. So our correct answer in this scenario would be D. Moving on to the next question, which reads, public participation in a democracy is the process where citizens provide feedback on decision-making to influence government policies. So in this case, our correct answer will be B. Then moving on to the next question, which is 1.1.4. Writing a reflection on a project should mainly focus on. In this case, when you are writing a reflection, you are actually assessing how the knowledge of the research project enhanced your general knowledge or your general understanding. So it is how the task enhanced your knowledge of the topic. That is what we refer to as reflection. So the correct answer in this scenario will be the letter C. When the next question, which is 1.1.5, when a question instructs you to illustrate your answer with a case study, you are then expected to refer to specific examples supporting your point. So in this scenario, or in this case, the correct answer will be the letter A. Moving on to the next page, we have question 1.2, which reads, give one word or term for each of the following descriptions. Write only the word or term next to the question numbers, 1.2.1 to 1.2.3 in the answer book. So in this case, we are only listing one word. So the purposeful spreading of misleading information to advance a certain political cause or philosophy is known as propaganda. It is known as propaganda. Then moving on to the next question, 1.2.2, a formal organization of workers that participates in collective bargaining on behalf of its members in the workplace is known as a trade union. It is known as a trade union. Then 1.2.3, a form of favoritism whereby close friends or associates are given position of power. When you give close members of the family positions of power simply because of your relationship, it is known as nepotism. That is an example of nepotism. That is an example of nepotism. Moving on to question 1.3. Answer the following questions by writing the answer next to the question numbers 1.3.1 to 1.3.3 in the answer book. Set two possible financial challenges for an upcoming entrepreneur. So entrepreneurs, we are talking about people who start businesses. So when people, an upcoming entrepreneur, when they start business, one of the problems or the challenges which they are going to come across in terms of finance is the issue of inconsistent cash flow. So that is the first issue, inconsistent. The first point is inconsistent cash flow into the company can be a financial challenge which they can encounter. In addition to that, they might start their business by borrowing money from somewhere. So as a result, they may face too much debt. Too much debt. For example, when they borrow, money to start the business, they would need to pay back the people who lent them that particular money. Then we also have problems like poor tax compliance. Poor tax compliance. When you are in business, you are also supposed to pay tax to the South African Revenue Services. So they might not have enough information about tax compliance. So the issue of tax compliance is another financial challenge which young entrepreneurs may face. In addition to that, we also have issues such as bad credit, whereby you give people services or goods on credit and they don't pay you back. So those are some of the financial challenges for an upcoming social entrepreneur. Then the following question reads, explain the term redress in the workplace. So we are not only explaining it in general terms, but specifically for the work environment. So when we talk about redress in the work environment, it refers to compensation. Compensation for unfair treatment. When you are unfairly treated in the workplace, you get what we call redress. So you can be paid in monetary terms, or you can be given other methods of compensation. Then you can also say that it is compensation for a grievance. Compensation for a grievance. So these are the two possible responses for question 1.3.2. 1.3.3, discuss the benefit of taking a gap year when deciding on a final career, final choice. Taking a gap year is when you take 1 year in which you don't study or you don't commit yourself to a particular job, especially perhaps after matric, you might find yourself taking a gap year whereby you are not studying or you are not engaged in a career. So we are looking at the benefits, the advantage of a gap year. So it offers an opportunity for personal development. Opportunity for personal development. You can actually take a gap year to develop yourself. For example, to acquire new skills, such as acquiring a driver's license, which is part of personal development. Then in addition to that, you can also say that it allows you the opportunity of refreshing. It is a refreshing experience, which allows a clear mind. So when you have a clear mind, you can actually get to determine what exactly you need to accomplish in life. In addition to that, it also gives people exposure. A gap year can actually give you exposure. Exposure to new ideas. That is the advantage of taking a gap year. Moving on to the next question, which requires us to look at the infographic which is provided. Personal fitness and health goals. Committing to a consistent workout routine, lifestyle, and nutritional plan will not only build your body, it will also build your mind. Describe one social benefit of including recreational activities in a personal lifestyle. So when you engage in recreational activities, leisure activities, which can be sport activities, it actually results in improved mental and physical health. And physical health. It results in mental and physical health. In addition to that, it improves your self-esteem. It actually improves your self-esteem. It improves your self-esteem. Then it increases energy. Energy levels. It can actually increase your energy levels. Then moving on to 1.4.2, explain how following a consistent exercise routine could contribute to your mental well-being. So it results in improved skin health. Improved skin health. Better cardiovascular health. Cardiovascular health. Cardiovascular, it refers to the health of the heart. So it actually improves the heart. In addition to that, the heart and circulation, blood circulation as well. Then it also enhances better relaxation. Better relaxation. People can actually relax in a better way. Then, in addition to that, we can also add better sleep. After engaging in physical activities, if you are suffering from sleeping disorders, you end up experiencing better sleep. In addition to that, it also protects the heart, protects the hearts. Then you can also add that it builds strong bonds. So it actually improves the skeletal system as well. So moving on to 1.4.3, which reads, explain how following a consistent, that is the question which you have answered, 1.1.1.4.3, discuss one possible advantage of following a balanced nutritional plan on a person's long-term physical health. So a nutritional plan, it is basically a plan of what you eat, which we actually call a balanced diet. So the advantage of having a nutritional plan is that it protects you from getting lifestyle diseases. It protects you from lifestyle diseases. Then it improves the immune system. For example, taking a lot of vegetables is actually good for your immune system. It improves your immune system. Your immune system. It improves your immune system. That's, or those are some of the benefits of, those are some of the benefits of having a healthy diet. All right, moving on to the next question. The next question reads, Moving on to section B, which is a compulsory section. In this section, you're supposed to answer all the questions, then write in full sentences. Then there is an extract which is there. Read the extract below and answer the questions that follow. The value of work, Generation Z and the changing world of work. Generation Z are individuals born between 1997 and 2012. Most of them are exposed to a world of widespread technology, tech, social media, and also internet access. They constantly strive for a better work-life balance and healthy relationships. They place value on the human experience, recognizing that there is more to life than work. This unique perspective shapes their behavior and the way they value work, either at school or in the workplace. Generation Z consider transparency and openness, and more important than experience, they are always hungry for feedback, so much so that 73% are willing to question authority, resign if they do not receive regular feedback. Now, moving on to the first question on this section, which actually reads, define the term value of work. So when you talk about value of work, we are talking about the amount of money that a task is worth. The amount of money that a task is worth. The amount of money that a task is worth. This is known as value of work. Moving on to the next question. Explain how having, or sorry, 2.2. Describe how Generation Z's experience of technology could enhance their problem-solving skills in the workplace. So the use of technology in the workplace, it enables remote learning. It actually enables remote learning. Then it also allows us to effectively to manage repetitive tasks easily. It allows easier management of repetitive tasks. Repetitive Repetitive tasks. So these are some of the benefits of using technology in the workplace. Moving on to question 2.3. Explain how having internet access could improve one's strategy to complete tasks or projects more effectively. So when you have internet access, it allows easier research. Easier research or access to multiple sources of information. Of information, it allows much the use of multiple sources of information. Then moving on to 2.3. 2.4, discuss two advantages for young workers who maintain a healthy work-life balance. Will you effectively balance your work life and also your social life? It actually results in enhanced physical health. Enhanced physical health. That is the first benefit. Then, in addition to that, higher job satisfaction. job satisfaction. Higher job satisfaction. Then in addition to that, we have 2.5, assess the value of regular feedback for employers within the work environment. Regular feedback is whereby you comment on the progress of employees in the workplace. So when you provide regular feedback, it builds a culture of respect and trust. It builds a culture of respect and trust. So it allows a culture of respect and trust. Then in addition to that, we need to move on to recommend two ways in which you could sustain effective relationships in the workplace. Two ways in which you can sustain effective relationships in the workplace. The next question reads, recommend two ways in which you could sustain effective relationships in the workplace. In each answer, also indicate how this may enable you to be more productive at work. So how can you improve two ways in which you can could sustain effective relationships in the workplace? So you can do that through effective communication. Communication with colleagues, with co-workers, enables good working relationships. Good communication, it also fosters teamwork, a sense of teamwork in the workplace. Which results in more production. So that is the first thing. In addition to that, it's actually you need also to provide moral support to colleagues. Providing moral support to colleagues enhances productivity. Productivity Then in addition to that, providing empathy. Leads to teamwork again, which improves productivity. So these are some of the ways in which you can use to sustain effective relationships in the workplace. Moving on to the third question. The third question reads, read the extracts below and answer the questions that follow. Study skills. Dishonesty in examinations on the increase. The penalties of being dishonest during matriculation examinations could include the results being invalid and a postponement of the examinations that are to follow. If learners are discovered to have had access to or circulated leaked question papers, they could also face criminal charges. It is therefore very important that learners understand the examination ethics, just like work ethics. It means to follow rules, guidelines, and moral principles. These give direction on how assessments are conducted or the manner in which it impacts on your professional life in the future. As a learner, failure to adhere to these moral principles could impact admission to higher education institutions. Over 1,000 grade 12 learners were banned from sitting for examinations after being found guilty of cheating during the 2022 National Senior Certificate NSC examinations. These learners will only be permitted to sit for NSC examinations after disciplinary hearings. Grade 12 learners are obligated to sign an NSC examination pledge before the commencement of the final examinations as a formal commitment to upholding the values and rules of this pledge, which may motivate learners to commit to academic integrity. So the first question reads, state two actions that you may unintentionally commit in the examination room that are considered to be dishonest. State two actions that you may unintentionally commit in the examination room that may be considered to be dishonest. So for example, carrying electronic devices by accident, though people are scanned before the entrance, né? Electronic devices by accident. Then you can also mention accidentally carrying crib notes. Crib notes. So these are two actions which you might do unintentionally through forgetting, whereby you can carry electronic devices which are not allowed in the examination room, or accidentally carrying crib notes, which are also not allowed in the examination room. Why do you think that learners may feel pressurized to perform well in the NSC examination? So, social expectations. Social expectations, for example, when results are due to be announced, it becomes a national issue. So, all expectations from the society can actually make you feel pressurized to perform well in the examination. So social expectations, then family expectations. Expectations, they play a role. In addition to family expectations, we also have things like we live in a competitive world. So you may feel pressured to do better than your friends or to do better than your siblings. So we live in a world of competition. So competitive environment. The competitive environment which we live in, it can actually result in you feeling pressured. In addition to this, we also have pressure from teachers and parents, from teachers as well. Parents, the pressure which they put on you, it actually results in you feeling being pressured to perform well. Moving on to the next question, explain how dishonesty during the NSC examinations could impact a learner's admission to higher educational institution. So the first point which I would want to make is that colleges and universities, colleges and universities, they actually take academic integrity seriously. They value academic integrity. They value academic integrity. They value academic integrity, so they might not. So they might not admit you. They may not admit you to the institution. You might not get a place at all. If you are guilty of cheating examinations, they may not even allocate you a place. So that is how being dishonest in the NSC examinations could impact a learner's admission to higher education institution. The next question, 3.4, discuss two ways in which you could revise your own study strategies to ensure that you are well planned for the examinations. So the first thing which you can list is that you can incorporating technology. You can actually incorporate technology to assist you with revision. You with revision. For example, you can actually watch YouTube videos on certain concepts or on certain lessons to assist you with revision. So that is the first point. Then in addition to that, you can also prioritize your weak areas. Give more time to things which you struggle with. Prioritize weak areas. That is how you can also do. Then in addition to that, you can also develop a study timetable. A study timetable. You need to develop a study timetable. Moving on to the next question, 3.5. Assess two ways in which honoring the NSC examination pledge may help you to maintain academic integrity. So it actually it assess two ways in which honoring the NSC examination pledge may help you maintain academic integrity. All right. Honoring the pledge, it actually make you honor the rules, the examination rules. It reminds you, it guides you rather, to do the correct thing during examination. During the examination. Then moving on to the next question, which is question 3.6. Question 3.6 reads, analyze how having strong work ethics can enhance your professional skills. Analyze how having strong ethics could enhance your professional skills. So there are several ways in which you can enhance your professional skills by having strong ethics. You become more productive in the workplace. Then strong work ethics, they promote Teamwork in the workplace. When you have strong work ethics, it promotes teamwork. In addition to that, you earn the trust and respect from colleagues. Respect from colleagues. That is how strong work ethics might be useful in the workplace. Moving on to section C, where you are only supposed to answer two questions in this section. Your responses must consist of paragraphs. Marks will only be allocated to responses written in full sentences. So, question four reads: read the extract below and answer the questions that follow. The role of media coverage of sports and sports personalities. Coverage of sports and sports personalities varies in the media. Media coverage of sports personalities can lead to their fame and success. It can also draw attention to scandals resulting in bad publicity and undue pressure on these individuals. Yet these individuals may inspire young people to pursue careers in sports. So the first question reads: briefly state four roles of the media in promoting sports in South Africa. Briefly state four roles of the media. So what is the role of the media in promoting sports in South Africa? So the first thing is that the media, it raise awareness on sports. That is the first point which I'm going to take. The media raises awareness of sports. Of sports. What do we mean by this? They actually let us know what is happening in the sports arena. For example, they give us fixtures of games which are going to be played. They also give us analysis of the games which are being played. Then also, in addition to that, it showcases sports, the media. Showcases the media showcases the value of sports. The value of sports. The media, it also provides analysis. Provides insight and analysis of sports events. Analysis of sports events. Analysis of sports events. In addition to that, you can also say that the media actually, increases visibility of sports. It actually increases the visibility of sports. So these are the four roles of media in promoting sports in South Africa. Moving on to the next question, discuss in detail how sports personalities could potentially influence young people to consider sports. All right. So sports personalities like sports presenters or pundits or sports analysts, they act as role models. Act as role models to the youth. That is the first point. They act as role models to the youth. Then the next point, they also provide mentorship. Provide mentorship in addition to mentorship, you can also include the fact that they demonstrate The sports personalities, they demonstrate. They demonstrate hard work, passion, which inspires young people. They demonstrate passion, hard work, which inspires the young youth. Then
You can also let that.
they promote sports personalities. Promote positive values, values which can be learned by young people. And they will end up will end up taking careers in sports. If you look at most sports personalities, they actually have their role models, which they try to imitate, or their idols, which they try to imitate. So they'll end up taking careers in sport. Okay, moving on to the next bullet. Examine two ways in which the media could report more responsibly on alleged or suspected scandals. So the media is a role of informing people, but when they report about scandals of sports personalities, they need to do that in a very, very responsible way. For example, the media should verify facts before publishing. Before publishing. So they need to do a little bit of verification of the facts which they are reporting on, because it can actually affect the career of the person whom they are reporting about. Then, quoting credible sources. So when they are looking for information, let them quote credible sources to make sure that the information came from sources which can be trusted. Quoting from credible sources. In addition to that, the media also needs to respect people's privacy. Respecting people's privacy. Respect of people's privacy is of importance. Then they should also provide context. Provide context. Of the issue they are reporting about. They should contextualize it properly, being reported. In addition to this, the media is also a responsibility of focus on the issue at hand. Issue at hand. And not the person. Of focus on the issue at hand, not the person. So, in other words, we are saying that they should avoid character assassination. Character assassination. Assassination. So, these are some of the ways in which the media could report more responsibly on alleged or suspected scandals of sports personalities. So this brings us to the end of Question four. Now moving on to question five, which requires us to read the extract which is below and answer the questions that follow. Social and environmental responsibility, participation in community service. Social and environmental responsibility or community service is the act of being accountable for one's action and behavior in a manner that benefits society at large. Through engaging in community service, the youth may also gain valuable employability skills. South African youth are well aware of their social responsibility towards society through youth programs. Many young people are now empowered to take the initiative in making positive changes in their communities. Now, moving on to the next question. The next question reads, write paragraphs on social and environmental responsibility. So briefly state four ways in which young people could promote safe and healthy living environments. So young people, they have a responsibility in the community of promoting safe and healthy environments by doing the following things. They can spread They can spread information on health and environmental awareness. So they can actually spread information on environmental awareness. In addition to that, young people can use sustainable alternatives of energies. For example, instead of using fossil fuels, young people can come up with new innovative fuels which do not pollute the environment. In addition to that, we can talk about campaigns young people can start recycling of waste products, then reducing pollution. Then launching community gardens. Gardens which can provide vegetables which promote healthy living. Then young people can also volunteer. They can also reduce pollution. They can launch community programs using sustainable alternatives, spread the message about environmental and health awareness. All those are relevant points there. Then the next question reads, discuss in detail how participation in a community service would help the youth improve their employable skills. So indirectly, we are being asked about the benefits of volunteering. The benefits of volunteering, it teaches valuable skills. Valuable skills like teamwork. Collaboration. communication, how to communicate in a group. In addition to that, volunteering,
volunteering
keeps you up to date. In terms of the latest recruitment trends. It keeps you up to date with the latest recruitment trends. In addition to that, we also need to add that volunteering broadens it widens your network. It widens your network. Then
it actually widens your network.
You can meet new contacts. Who can connect you with job opportunities? So you can meet new contacts who can connect you with job opportunities. Then in addition to that, we need to answer the last question, which is examine two ways in which empowered people could motivate the other youth to address social issues in society. So when we have an empowered youth, especially young people, they can be empowered through education. So empowered youth can empower other youth. Empowered youth may motivate other youth through critical thinking, All right, the second way, they can give other youth problem-solving techniques which may be useful in addressing social challenges such as substance abuse, gender-based violence, etc. So that is how empowered youth can assist also other youths in the community. So this brings us to the end of question five. Moving on to question six. Question six requires us to read the extract which is given. Read the extract below and answer the questions that follow. Lifestyle diseases, TB, a silent killer. Tuberculosis is a preventable and curable disease, yet 1.5 million people die from TB each year, making it the world's top infectious killer. Lifestyle factors and stigmatization play an important role in the spreading of TB in communities. In order to manage this disease effectively, early treatment is important. Glossary, stigmatization, where individuals are unfairly treated and discriminated against due to conditions that are seen as undesirable in society. Then, moving on to the next question, use the following as a guideline. Briefly state four lifestyle factors that may increase the risk of a person contracting tuberculosis. So TB is usually associated with overcrowding. So the first point is overcrowded conditions. Enable the transmission of the TB disease. Transmission of TB. TB is an airborne disease. So if people live in overcrowded conditions, it can be easily transmitted. TB, that is the first factor. Then moving on to the next factor, the second one. Then working in environments with many people. People, e.g. hospitals, schools, prisons. Then in addition to that, issues such as other conditions such as HIV and AIDS. When you're infected with HIV or AIDS, you can easily transmit, or you can easily get TB. Then we also, since it affects the lungs, we also have things like smoking. They can actually enable you to transmit the disease, smoking. Then we also have things like other conditions such as diabetes. And also we have things such as undernutrition or malnutrition. When you're not eating enough of good food or balanced diet, nutrition, malnutrition. So you should also be able to eat well so that you can avoid contracting TB. So these are the lifestyle factors. So if HIV and AIDS, smoking, diabetes, malnutrition, overcrowded conditions, working environment where there are many people. Now, the next question reads, discuss in detail how early treatment of TB could help individuals who are infected to manage the disease more effectively. So early detection, it prevents drug resistance. If you start getting treatment for TB, it prevents drug resistance, whereby drug resistance is a situation whereby the drugs which you'll be taking or the medication which you'll be taking might not work. So that is known as drug resistance. Then another thing, TB medications is effective in the early stages. TV medication is effective in early stages. TB medication is effective in early stages. When you take medication in the early stages, it is very, very easy to treat the disease. But at a later stage, it might be too late. Then it's early treatment saves money and time. Then in addition to that, it reduces transmission to the next person. It reduces transmission to the next person. Then the next question reads, examine the possible impact of stigmatization on the effectiveness of treatment for TB infected individuals. So when people are discriminated or they are stigmatized, they become reluctant. Stigmatization discourages infected people to seek help. To get medical attention. They are afraid to speak out about their status or condition. So at the end of the day, they cannot get to the hospitals or to the clinic so that they can be treated. So stigmatization discourages infected people to get medical attention. Then the next one is that stigmatization can lead to discrimination. Stigmatization can lead to discrimination. Of infected it can lead to stigmatization of infected people. They are treated by community as outcasts, which can result in worsening of the sickness. Of the disease. So they are mentally affected leading to depression. Or even death. In addition to this, we can also say that stigma delays treatment, delays early detection of the disease and treatment of the disease. Stigma delays early treatment of this particular disease resulting in deterioration of the health of the affected or infected. Of the
infected person.
Which can lead to early death. Which can result lead to early death of the patient. Which can result in early day death of the patient. Then stigma also results in social isolation. When someone is socially isolated, they do not interact with other community members. This can affect the mental health of the patient. Person infected. Which can affect the mental health of the person infected and worsen the condition, the health condition rather. Leading to early death. Leading to early death. So this brings us to the end of the last question. So remember, when you answer questions in section C, you are supposed to write in full sentences as far as possible. Then in addition to that, we also encourage you to make use of statements, a qualifier, and an outcome. So that is how you answer section C. So it brings us to the end of this section. Hoping to meet you in the next session. Thank you.